all stand and join in worship together this morning. Lord, we have nothing left to do but sing for you, Lord Jesus, and we thank you.
Lord, I lift you higher.
Welcome, church. Why don't you go ahead and greet your neighbor?
Good morning. If you wouldn't mind finding a seat, we're going to get started. Unless you're in the middle of a really, really great greeting, just keep hugging it out. Do whatever you got to do. We are glad to have you in worship, as always. I always have the privilege of bringing you announcements, and this morning I have kind of just one exclusive announcement. You can find this card in the welcome room. I'm excited about this because it has to do with kids. How many of you guys like kids? That was actually pretty weak. Yeah, this is a church that doesn't really like kids that much, but welcome. You guys do like kids, right? You know, this card is about the three camps that we have here this summer. We have a skate camp out at our awesome skate park. We have art camp, and we have VBS. And I was talking with Pastor Danny about our vision for these three camps. And you know what? I think sometimes we get kind of colluded ideas of what the Bible says, but Jesus is so clear about kids, isn't he? It doesn't take an expert to read and say that Jesus loves kids. And then he goes a step further and says, I got some strong warnings for anyone who would try to keep kids from me. I'll let you read it yourself because I don't want to like be a dark cloud on you this morning, but it says something about tying a millstone around your neck. Anyways, our vision for kids is that there would be no hurdles to kids getting involved this summer at Zion Community Church in any of these three camps. If you have a child on your heart, maybe they're your own kids, maybe it's a niece or a nephew, a kid in the neighborhood, and you're looking here and you're thinking, I don't know if $30 is going to fly for a skate camp, just bring that kid. We'll figure out the money along the way. There's been a lot of great people who have been helping us, especially with VBS. VBS this summer is totally free. Literally, there is no obstacle to kids being part of VBS. If you would like to participate in that, we've estimated the cost at about $40 per kid. If you would like to sponsor a child for $40, they're going to get to come to VBS for free. Does that sound awesome? Awesome. Well, I'm going to pass it off to Pastor Danny here. He has kids. He loves kids, so he's part of the team too. And here he is.
Thank you, Andy. I do love kids. I do have kids. Hey, just one quick note on that, especially for, well, all the camps. You can go online and register real easily. And the reason we need you to register is because we get all these kids really cool t-shirts, and they wear them around. They love their shirts. We want to just know their sizes. So please take the time to do that if you're going to have your kids there. Well, welcome, everyone. It's really good to see you this morning. Is it good to see me? I mean, it's good to see you. I know you're thinking that... you're not used to seeing me with glasses, and I'm wearing them for respect. That's why I want a little more respect around here. And I put these glasses on, and people are like, man, you're so smart. So anyways, that's what that's all about. This morning, we have a report from two of our deacons, from George and from Don. And how many of you want to hear an update on the sanctuary progress? Before I have them come up, I just want to tell you, these guys are stellar. And our entire board of deacons, we are so blessed to have the level of leadership and skill. And I want you all just to thank them by just giving them a big round of applause. They've been working hard. We had this moment in one of our board meetings, and George, I don't know if you remember this, but it was one of my favorite moments. There's been a couple, and one time I actually got a camera out and took a picture of it because it was like history in the making as these guys were poring over plans and making decisions. But this one, how many of you know when you do renovations, there's little obstacles you face along the way, and plans change, and things cost more than you think, and blah, blah, blah. Well, at one point, George made this quote. And George, I don't know if you remember, but you said, you know, I like plan B so much that I'm going to start calling it plan A, you know? And that was kind of a something that I love. So anyways, that's where we're at this morning. And I want George to come up and just share an update, and Don will follow him. Give him a big round of applause and welcome him.
Thank you, Pastor. I'd like the deacons to stand that are here, please. I always want them to stand with me because if you like what I have to say, look at me. If you don't, glare at them. And please remain standing as I go through my report. I do want you seriously afterwards to, if you have questions, see one of us, and we'll be happy to answer your questions. How many of you remember that we have said over and over again that this building campaign is not about bricks and mortar? Everybody remember that? We've said it many, many, many times. And I was thinking about that when I prepared my notes and thought about what has occurred in the last 2 years here. And please bear with me and take this journey with me. I was looking at the time when we upgraded the skate park. And now that we see enormous number of kids that come and enjoy the skate park, thank you to Jesse and the team that do that. How about a hand for them? And then we renovated the classrooms, and Krista and Amy and others were so creative in what was created there, and most of all, the kids are safe, and they're having a great time playing and learning. And then the playground, one of my favorites that we struggled with because we thought it was a lesser priority, and we decided to suck it up and bring up move up the money, and now the kids don't want to leave that. And Toby Dean, thank you very much for that, Toby. And then the walkway. Remember when it was a dark alley and nobody wanted to walk down there at night? And now everybody's in the walkway, and we get there early, and we have breakfast and fellowship even before service. One day, my goal is we're going to serve menudo and pozole there. Yeah? And then there's Weiss Fellowship. Phyllis, what do you think of Weiss? Done a great job here. I was worried about having service here, and the fact of the matter is that we've come closer together, haven't we? And it's been great. And so... and then finally, Pastor and his staff had the courage to suspend Wednesday night and go back and pray and think and see if we can come up with a better way to serve our congregation. And there'll be an announcement about that soon. But I just want to draw a parallel between what we've been doing physically and then what the programs have followed with that and the impact that it's made on all of you in our church and the transformation that I think is going on. So the journey continues, and I'm here to report on the sanctuary. 6 months ago, we came before you and showed you great plans and what it would cost and what we were going to do, and showed you how we would pay for it, and we went ahead and secured a number of donors and borrowed money at $1.4 million. And you've been inside the sanctuary. How many of you remember the great Easter service that we had in the sanctuary? Wasn't that great? Right? And so why are we not in the sanctuary now? Well, how many of you have had construction projects in your homes? Okay, and Pastor talked about it already. Let me tell you what's occurred. We found out that the building isn't safe along the way. We found out that we had to retrofit for seismic issues that cost us $58,000 more and a delay. We found out that despite the fact that we reviewed our plans with the city over and over and over again, the fire department came and said, you got to put sprinklers up. And we said, but we checked, and everybody said it was okay. And they said, no, we don't care. You must put sprinklers up. That was $75,000 more and a delay. And then we find out as we open the building up that there's no insulation in the building. And that isn't safe. All these, by the way, are all safety issues that we had to address. So needless to say, we had a lot of delay and a lot of unexpected cost. And as they opened up the building, Don and the contractor, David, got together and made an important recommendation to us. Something we had to deal with at the board level, and that is they recommended, for the sake of cost and schedule, to combine phase one and phase two. You remember, we're going to do the sanctuary first inside and then do the outside second. And they've recommended to us that we combine the two and that we do it now. So what does that mean exactly? Phase one is a cost of $1.4 million. We have secured the funding for that. Phase two is $1.2 million. We have not secured the funding for that. We think if we combine these two, and I'll talk more about how we pay for this later, if we combine these two, we can be in the sanctuary by the end of the year and then do the external soon thereafter. So how many of you think we should go forward with this? Okay. Thank you. You're all smarter than you look. The board prayed a lot and discussed it a lot, and we have voted to go forward, combine the two phases, and get started immediately. What does that mean exactly? Don is working with a contractor to finalize the cost and the schedule of this. By the way, if I thought the delays were caused by the contractor, I would have immediately told his mother, and I would have hit him upside the head. For those of you that don't know, he's my brother. But no, it wasn't his fault. And so how do we pay for this? The 1.4 is secured. The 1.2 is not. I've asked David Avina. David, wave your hands. David. We're so fortunate. David's a CPA, and he has worked with us on the first loan. I've asked him to go back to our bank and begin the process of securing phase two, the $1.2 million thereabouts, and to get started now so that we don't lose any time. We're going to be back to you all on how you could help us with phase two. That'll come at a later date. For now, I want to bring up Don Granger. But before he takes the mic, I want to tell you something. We talked about the board before and the talent that we have. Imagine that on the board you have an architect. And imagine that on the board you have a CPA. How fortunate is that? Don Granger, I'm telling you, and I want to embarrass him, has been phenomenal. His expertise and, more importantly, his commitment to what we're doing here has been amazing. But the thing that cracks me up, and Pastor, you talked about, you're remembering certain moments. Don Granger, anytime you ask him a question about anything, he will reach into his briefcase and pull out exactly the document you're talking about. I don't know how he does that, but he always has the information and an answer for us. Please welcome Don Granger.
How many of you have been fortunate enough to go through a pregnancy? Well, the doctors moved our due date. And most of this stuff is as a result of a building that's 40 years old that does not meet current codes. And in the beginning, we wanted to do this in a phased project. But when you get into, there's things in phase two that are now spilling over into phase one. They came back to us and said, you have to add a fire sprinkler system. And the thing is, it's not in any national building code. It's not in the fire code. But Orange has a municipal city code because there's a bunch of old buildings here that they want a fire suppression system put in these buildings. And so anytime you take out a permit to remodel or renovate your building, they're going to slap you for it. And they didn't. It went through plan check. It didn't come up in plan check, and it's now an issue. So we were at the point in there where we were getting ready to start covering up all the framing, you know, with drywall, and start doing the finish work and pushing for the opening in July, and they hit this. And so you get into that, and then, okay, as we started to prepare plans to do phase two, which was the office renovation and adding the restrooms, the minute you touch the air conditioning units, you have to go through calculations, Title 24 energy code, and you start finding out, okay, in order to meet this, you have to add insulation to all of the exterior walls. You have to add insulation in the ceiling. There was nothing up there. And so you can't do that. You can't finish phase one until you do this. So all of this stuff is starting to intermingle. And that's when we made the decision to, we have got to do it now, because you can't put something up with the thought of 6 months later you're going to come in here and tear it out to do this. The thing that the other thing that's happening is, you know, the contemporary elevation design that you see on the outside, you're not going to get that. Just forget about it. We are going to do something. The city has an ordinance also that says, and because this, we were going to do this 3 or 4 years down the line. And so we hadn't developed anything beyond these conceptual sketches. Well, now we've begun discussions with the city. And because we are in a historical neighborhood, and because we're in a residential area, they don't feel that that design fits in the neighborhood. They also... any building that's over 40 years old in the city, if you want to touch the exterior design of this building, you have to go through a historical analysis to see if there's any historical significance to keep that design. And I go, you got to be kidding. It's a concrete tilt-up building with some arches on it that are too spindly, and it looks stupid, you know? But we had to pay an outside consultant $8,000 to do a historical report. They reported back, and this is all taking months, just ping-ponging back and forth. The historical report says there's no historical significance. But the city wants more information. So I'm waiting for the additional report to go back to the city. But are you familiar with the Orange Library? Okay. That's kind of a modern mission style. And it kind of fits with the building, the way that this building is built. So we are going to design, we have some sketches, but it's going to be going back and forth with the city, but that's the direction that we're headed. We're going to be doing something along those lines. We are still going to have an entry tower. They have limitations to the height that we are doing it at, but it's this big, long process, and it's going to take once they tell me that, okay, we can go along with the style that you are sketching out here. It's a 3 or 4 month process through city meetings, design review boards, and all of these different stuff to get the authorization to go ahead and proceed. And then we'll start drawings on the actual exterior. So what's going to happen is the sanctuary, the offices, like we said, it'll run to the end of the year. Unless there's complications with our pregnancy. And the exterior work will follow after that. So we should be able to take occupancy in the sanctuary, and then just be aware that there is still, because of all of these hoops that we have to jump through, that the exterior won't be finished at the same time as we take possession inside the building. So that's where we are.
I'm here to receive the offering. I got the easy job. Oh, goodness. You know, it's great to know that you have a board like we have in place. And you know what? God has blessed this church with good, godly men that love the Lord, that have the best interest of this church in mind. And it's a very reassuring thing when you know who these men are. So, you know, we're in good hands, and let's make sure that we continue to pray and cover them so that God blesses them in his meetings and gives the church favor every step of the way. Amen? Amen. Let's pray. Father God, we are so grateful to be together this morning. We ask, Lord God, that your presence would fill this place, that, Lord, as we enter into worship and as we have a chance to give of our tithes and offerings to you, that, God, we would take a moment and really pause from our busyness and just even what we've heard, that, God, we would lift it up to you, knowing that, Lord God, you are in control of everything. So, Father, we give this morning out of a joyful heart. We give because you have given to each one of us, and we are thankful. So, Lord, bless this day, we pray. Bless Pastor Ben and the worship team. God, I pray an anointing upon Pastor Danny as he brings the word. Father, let this day honor and glorify you. We thank you and we give you praise in your son's name. Amen.
Love hidden. give you my trust, Jesus, for you are my God, you are enough, Jesus, Jesus, my heart.
Is right now when we're worshiping and we've just sung the song, I Surrender. And I love this point in our service where we're able just to go, God, here's everything. And you may have done that when you walked through the doors, but I want to give you the chance to do it now as we sing it again, as we just all to Jesus, I surrender. Just give you that opportunity to hand stuff over to God. He is so faithful. He can handle it. He cares for us. And so as they sing it, you know, some of the ways that we do it is oftentimes we just lift our hands to the Lord. It's just a sign of worship that we surrender to Him. You don't have to do that. You're welcome to do it if that helps. But the point is, give it to Him. It's just give it to Him as best as you know how. Just give Him everything, especially the things that are weighed down upon you, the things that you have no control over, the things that are heavy. Let's surrender them to Jesus.
Trust you in your presence.
I thank you that you promise to be with us always. I thank you, Lord, that your word says that you're a friend that sticks closer than a brother. I thank you, Lord, that the picture of your Holy Spirit is our helper, our comfort. You're standing right by our side. Lord, even more, you dwell in us. God, we're grateful today. We're so grateful. Lord, we give you all the praise and all the glory, and we say thank you, God. Would you just say thank you to the Lord? However you want to say it, just say thank you to God. Something about gratitude, huh? Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. Lord, we honor you here in this place, and we pray that as we break open your word, that it would nourish us. It would nourish our soul. And we're open. Lord, we welcome you. We welcome you into every place in our heart, Lord. Those certain doors that we keep shut, those closets that we hide all our junk in, God, we open up wide. And we say, come, Lord, and reveal yourself to us. Thank you for truth, Lord. We don't make this stuff up, but you've left it for us in your word. And your word says that it is a lamp and a light. So come and shine upon us, Lord. We praise you, we thank you in your precious name, Jesus. And everybody said, amen. 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 All right. Amen.